surge all the way through our lives. So it's an honor for me and a delight to introduce you to Wenonah Hauter.
We need to know where we've been to know where we're going, right? And one of the major concerns that I have, and I'm sure most people have today who are keeping up on current events, is what's happening to our global climate. So we know that fracking today, 80% of it since 2012, has been for oil. But we know that it's being justified for the future as natural gas that will be a bridge fuel to renewable energy. And that's one of the things that I'm really going to address tonight. It turns out that the modeling for climate change has been based on a 100-year time frame. And that's a real problem. We do know that carbon stays in the atmosphere for a very long time, and most of the modeling has been looking at carbon. But it also turns out that methane, which is what natural gas is a very potent greenhouse gas, almost 90 times more potent in the first 20 years after emissions. And we know that we need to do something about emissions beginning in the next 10 to 15 years. So the idea that natural gas is a bridge fuel is completely false. And one of the things that we plan to do at Food and Water Watch is really make the case that we should be using a 20-year time frame to look at greenhouse gases. So it's really climate change that's the first reason that I wrote Frackopoly, and trying to set things clear about what the impacts of methane will be in the long term. The second reason that I wrote Frackopoly is really about the people on the front lines of fracking whose lives are being impacted. And there are 15 million people, probably more today, but my citation is for 15 million people in the book. We know there are at least 15 million that live within 1 mile of a fracking operation. They are sick, their water is polluted, there are all sorts of impacts. And people are unable to sell their homes once their water is polluted. And people want to protect their children. They don't want their children to be exposed to the polluted air and the polluted water. So there's been a lot of pain and suffering in communities around the country. And one of the reasons that it's very hard to continue documenting this suffering is what the oil and gas industry does is basically set aside a budget for lawsuits and claims against their fracking operations. It's just the cost of doing business. And once someone's home is ruined or their water is ruined, they can't sell their home, they will sign the disclosure agreements that go with getting a check for some of the damage. And that means it's very difficult to document a lot of the problems. And one of the things that Food and Water Watch has been advocating for is congressional hearings to actually, under oath, ask people about what they've been through and to help document what's going on. We also know that the workers who are doing different pieces of the fracking operation also have a lot of health problems. And someone who's come out very publicly on this is Randy Moyer. He was an individual who drove a truck in Pennsylvania that took fracking waste from the operations. He had to clean out the truck and dump the waste into one of the evaporation ponds. And he got very, very sick. His health is ruined. And he's one of the several workers who are speaking out about what's going on with fracking operations. The next reason that I wrote Frackopoly is really about how are we going to move into alternative energy. Really, natural gas isn't the bridge fuel. Energy efficiency is the bridge fuel, using less energy, making sure our homes and businesses are retrofitted, and that community by community, we change the building codes so that people can have very energy efficient homes. And I'm going to talk about this quite a bit tonight, because right now the incentive is to use as much energy as possible. In the mid-1990s, I worked on a renewable energy project in 12 Midwestern states. Our slogan then was, renewables are ready. And they were. Even in the mid-1990s, wind was cost-effective as an energy source. And we know today that solar and wind are both very cost-effective. But when you look at energy usage, and how much energy or electricity was produced in 2015, you will see that only about 5.1% of the electricity used in this country in that year was from wind and solar. I mean, that's a stunning figure, and it shows how much work we must do to really move into this renewable energy future. So, what is fracking? Well, first of all, the technologies that came together around the turn of the 21st century that make fracking possible weren't available in the decades before. So we often hear people like T. Boone Pickens saying, I've been fracking for 50 years. Well, the technologies that make horizontal drilling and the high pressure fracking that I'm going to describe in a minute really only came to the forefront in about the last 20 years. It is true that the oil and gas industry has always used water in their drilling practices, and they continue to do so today for conventional drilling. But fracking brought a number of technologies together that make it possible to drill as far as 2 miles or more, a vertical well into shale, and then to drill a horizontal tunnel that is about 20 inches wide that can also go horizontally about 2 miles. And then the fracking takes place in different stages. And the actual fracking is the use of millions of gallons of water, very fine white sand, and different chemicals and solvents. And under very high pressure, this mixture called slick water is injected deep into the ground, and under different stages it goes into that horizontal tunnel, and the fracking is done. And what the fracking does, it cracks that very hard rock that it wasn't possible to drill in previously. All sorts of fractures. Nobody knows exactly what's going on that deep underground, what different pathways are created, where the fracking slick water may end up. And the other thing that usually isn't discussed by the industry or the mainstream media is the fact there is a lot of brine and radioactive material, different chemicals that are deep underground that would never come back up to the surface except when drilling takes place. So not only wastewater gushes back out of that well, along with the oil or natural gas, but a lot of that fluid, that brine, chemically laden and with lots of radioactive materials, also gushes up out of the well. Now, another point about fracking is how much water it takes to actually frack. The average national is 1.8 million gallons per well, but depending on the geology, it could be much more, as much as 13 million gallons in some wells in, say, Texas. So that is a lot of water. And what happens with this high pressure and the well casing, one of the problems that the oil and gas industry has always had with conventional drilling is that the casing, which is the cement that goes around the well head and down many feet into the ground, it's often compromised by the high pressure. This could happen over time or it could happen immediately. And that's one of the reasons that a lot of groundwater is actually contaminated by methane. And we know, we've all seen pictures of water on fire from methane. Another thing that happens is that sometimes the drilling is more shallow than 2 miles, and it actually hits aquifers. There are all sorts of different problems around the country with fracking and the contamination of water. Now, the other major problem associated with the wells and the water is the wastewater. So on average, every day, the oil and gas industry generates about 10.5 billion gallons of wastewater. That is a lot of wastewater to deal with. And we know that fracking often happens in places that are very dry. Texas, New Mexico, the Central Valley of California, places that there's no water. And so a lot of wastewater is ruined, really taken out of our ecosystem. Now, the wastewater is dealt with differently in different locations. In some states, for instance, in Colorado, the wastewater on some occasions is put into holding ponds, evaporation ponds, where the water is evaporated off, and then the solids are taken to a dump that can accept this kind of waste. We know that those dumps have many, many problems and are not properly regulated either. In other states, like Oklahoma, we know that the wastewater is being injected very, very deep underground. And it's being injected under higher pressure than has been used in the past, and greater volumes. And the result is that a state like Oklahoma, but many other states as well, are having earthquakes, and sometimes serious earthquakes. Now, before the fracking wastewater debacle a decade or more ago, Oklahoma would have maybe 1 to 3 3.0 magnitude earthquakes a year. Since this fracking wastewater disposal has been occurring, in 2015, there were 851 earthquakes 3.0 or larger, and if you look at all the earthquakes, more than 5,000 earthquakes. So this is definitely one of the problems. Many of the earthquakes in these rural states, or states where the fracking is going on in rural areas, are suffering lots of infrastructure problems. Now, you can imagine if it wasn't a rural area and these earthquakes occurred and it was a urban area, the amount of damage. Recently, this summer, there was a 5.8 magnitude earthquake in Oklahoma. There are lots of problems with wastewater, conventional and fracking wastewater. In California, where Chevron is a king oil company, lots of conventional drilling and fracking. And also, as I mentioned a few minutes ago, there's a water crisis. So one of the things that's happening with that water is pretty shocking. It's being used to water food crops. A very simple recycling process where they mix the wastewater with walnut shells. And then it's used in irrigation ditches for crops. And many of these are crops that we recognize from the grocery store, things like Sunview raisins, Halos, Cal Organic, Bee Sweet, Palm Wonderful, and Trinchero wines, which include Sutter wines. So this is a real scandal, and the advocacy community has been unable to get Governor Brown to do something about this. So there is a campaign that Food and Water Watch and a number of other groups are involved in to begin doing education across the country, because the Central Valley of California is a national breadbasket. And I know I've been speaking about Frackopoly across the country, and I think one of the things that's most shocking to people is that wastewater from the oil and gas industry with all of those chemicals is being used on food crops. Now, another problem with fracking is that it really pollutes the air. Because where you have fracking, you also have all of that infrastructure that goes with it, the processing facilities, the facilities where natural gas is condensed. And in some areas, they are beginning to plan for liquefied natural gas facilities that will then export gas overseas. Anyway, where there's processing actual fracking wells too, there are a lot of pollutants, air pollutants. And I know I have seen photos from activists who have to deal with this on a daily basis, like in Wyoming. You know, Wyoming should have pretty clean air, right? Because Wyoming doesn't have a large population. But instead, the air is very polluted. And the people who have to live near this, in this polluted air, have a lot of respiratory diseases, asthma, nausea, stomach problems. And there are now more than 550 studies that have been conducted, most of them since 2013. And more than 90% of them show different impacts of fracking. And it's becoming very well documented, the health effects, many of them from this air pollution. In fact, since I've written Frackopoly, Johns Hopkins Public School of Health, very prestigious university, has done some studies, and they've found that miscarriages, premature births, all sorts of lung disease are caused by, there's a correlation between being near a fracking site. So I think that as the research begins to catch up with what's going on around the country, we're going to see a lot more of these problems. Now, another problem, and this may be one that is on many people's minds during the latter part of 2016 and into 2017 is the pipes that are being built. And there are thousands of miles of interstate pipelines being built. There's been a lot of concern over the Dakota Access Pipeline that's in southwestern North Dakota on land that is sacred to the Sioux. There's a huge encampment there, very controversial. These kinds of pipelines are being built across the country in many regions. And in some cases, these pipelines are being built to transport oil, like the Dakota Access Pipeline. In other cases, it's for natural gas. And one of the things we've been able to document about the natural gas pipelines is that a lot of this natural gas is being sent into areas that don't currently use a lot of natural gas. They're trying to find new markets. And one of the most shocking things is that all of the rhetoric about the drilling and fracking being for energy independence, well, now that prices are low for gas and oil, it's really about profit and exporting oil and gas overseas. And there are a lot of liquefied natural gas plants, as I mentioned, being built that will do this transportation. And sadly, at the end of last year, 2015, in the big budget bill that passed, the Obama administration indicated that they would not make a fuss over the fact that oil would begin to be exported. And the ban on oil exports that's been in place since the early 1970s was lifted, and so now oil is being transported overseas as well. You know, all as a way to make the price of fossil fuels rise. Now, another issue is that a lot of the fracking is taking place in rural communities, communities that should be producing our food, right? But we know that we have a dysfunctional food system, that farmers have a very difficult time making a living, that a lot of commodity crops are grown, that are grown by a small percentage of farmers. And agriculture is the economic driver in rural communities. So without agriculture being vibrant, there are not jobs. So it's been very easy for the oil and gas industry to send landmen in to tell people that, you know, there's no problem with fracking. You'll hardly even notice that the rigs are here. They'll drill, and then you'll just have a well, and, you know, the dollars will come flowing in. Well, it hasn't turned out that way, and we know that many, many communities are really suffering from the effects of fracking. And one of the ways that they've really been affected is by what happens when the oil and gas industry comes to a small community where the roads are narrow, where people know one another, don't lock their doors, where there is just not a lot of ability to stop a major industry like the oil and gas industry from different abuses, especially a state like Pennsylvania, where the political, really the politicians in the state were, instead of strengthening any of the state regulations around oil and gas, they were throwing open the doors and deregulating. Oil and gas regulation is mostly done at the state level, and I will be talking in a little bit about the weakening of some of the federal rules. But in states like, well, most states where the oil and gas industry is really a dominant player in the state, very weak rules. Now, the average well takes 1,000 truckloads to build, large dump truckloads of different materials, sand, chemicals, water. And you can imagine the impact of that in rural communities. Lots of accidents, vehicle accidents, lots of spills of chemicals along the roadways, lots of damage to the road that tax dollars have to pay for the repairs. So a lot of the things that aren't actually discussed when we hear about how great it's going to be economically when the oil and gas industry moves in. And a few years ago, Food and Water Watch did a data dive in several fracked counties in Pennsylvania to see what some of the impacts were. And one of the things that we found is that some venereal diseases increase in these communities because there are a lot of young men moving into these communities, and there just is more increase in crime and other problems that happen when a lot of people come from out of state, have money in their pocket, and nothing to do in the off hours. And so it's a real problem. And the other thing that we know is those are the jobs that the young, unskilled workers do. They're very dangerous. In fact, the oil and gas industry has one of the highest rates of deaths and accidents of any industry in the country. And in fact, the Houston Chronicle did a terrific piece on worker injuries and deaths last year in 2015. And so the really skilled jobs where people make a lot of money tend to be people who go around to different areas and do the preparatory work for drilling. So that is one of the problems that happens with the industry. Now, there are other effects that we also don't hear much about. All of that fine white silica sand has to come from somewhere, right? And it is mined in places like Wisconsin, Minnesota, Iowa, and Illinois. These are big, ugly mines, often very close to the Mississippi River. It's dangerous to even live near one of these mines because silica is very much like asbestos. It causes lung disease. It's dangerous for the workers at the mines, the workers that are dealing with it in fracking, and the residents that live near these mines. Huge increase in this kind of mining in the upper Midwest of the US. Lots of accidents. And you know, it's very difficult to track the oil and gas accidents. Each state has its own method if they track. There is a corporate-sponsored website, Frack Tracker, that does some tracking, but we are somewhat skeptical of how thorough it is. I know in writing Frackopoly, I took a hard look at the data in North Dakota because there's so much fracking for oil there. It was very difficult to look at the data. Each file had to be opened independently. It would literally take weeks, months, probably years to print out all of the data and then to somehow correlate it to know how many accidents are happening and then to track if there is any follow-up to the accidents. So basically, we end up knowing about the accidents that happen near someone's home or someone sees it, because a lot of these accidents are very fiery. They're blowouts. It's a blowout on land, much like the blowout that occurred on BP Horizon. And so when there's a fire and a lot of publicity, we end up seeing news coverage and sometimes videos. Now, another kind of accident that is occurring are the oil trains, because oil is being shipped all around the country on trains that aren't designed for this very flammable and explosive liquid going very fast on tracks that are often not being maintained properly. And there have been many accidents in the last couple of years. There was an accident earlier this year in Portland, or near in Oregon, not in Portland, but not too far from Portland, where there was a problem with the track, major explosions. It took out a small town's water and sewage system, and then the waste started, the oil, what was left of the oil and the kind of the waste from the accident started flowing into the Columbia River, and a lot of effects. So this is a real problem when moving these fossil fuels around, and one of the reasons that it's really not sustainable. So that's kind of the 101 about fracking. Now, I want to spend the rest of my time this evening really talking about the history of the oil and gas industry and how we've ended up here, because I do think that to really start addressing these problems, we have to look at how we've ended up with really bad public policy and with an industry that's so powerful that it's writing the future of the planet, basically. I always like to start with Thomas Jefferson, because many of us learned in school that when Thomas Jefferson wrote the Bill of Rights, he wanted to include freedom from monopoly in the Bill of Rights. And of course, Alexander Hamilton, who is someone who is very much associated with the big banks and high finance, did not think that was a good idea. He was pretty supportive of allowing these financial interests to get as large as they wanted to get. That's had a lot of repercussions. And it wasn't because of consumer prices that Thomas Jefferson was concerned about this kind of economic power. It was really about political power and there being too much political power in the hands of too few. And there's been a debate about monopoly power many times in the history of our nation. Many times people have risen up and said enough is enough. And really that's one of the reasons I wrote Frackopoly, two books with an opoly, because I think that we really need to jumpstart that debate. Again, considering how weak our democracy is and how much corporations, how much power they have. And when you look at large economic interests, what you find is that they often have interlocking boards of directors. And I think this is pretty interesting, and it's really true with most industries, and it's, you know, it's not a conspiracy. It's really about economic interests who have a common goal, making money, working together on different boards to make sure that the companies that they're associated with are successful. And it's one of the reasons that we should have government do its job of regulation and let companies make money. We can't expect the companies are going to put good public policy before their profits. So I think that some of the most interesting interlocking boards of directors are about the media and the oil and gas industry and fracking, because I think one of the things that we can really see is we haven't had the best coverage of these really important issues, either around climate change or around fracking. And I think one of the reasons is because there are a lot of relationships there. And in fact, the media has become so consolidated. In the 1980s, when the consolidation happened under the Reagan administration, which I'm going to talk about in a few minutes, already the consolidation had begun, but there were actually 50 major media outlets. Today we have 6. So I think that that's one of the real impacts. Finance. I know whether you're talking about pipes or oil and gas exploration, export, finance plays a major role. And one of the pieces of research that we did recently at Food and Water Watch is we looked at who is investing in the Dakota Access Pipeline. And of course, there are some big banks, as you would expect, and they have invested about $10 billion. And right now, there are about $200 to $300 billion invested in fracking infrastructure, oil and gas infrastructure. And there's a very tight connection between finance and between all industries, but certainly with the oil and gas industry. And finance plays a major role in putting mergers and acquisitions together. I mean, they have a financial stake in this. They have customers that they advise on investments. So they have a stake in big investment in things that do well on the stock market. There's really a very close relationship between the big financial services institutions and promoting oil and gas. And I think that's one of the things that people don't often think about and that we're really going to have to shake up as we move forward. So I want to give kind of a quick history of the oil and gas industry. And most of us learned about John D. Rockefeller in high school, maybe college. He was someone who was had kind of figured out right after the Civil War how to make money from oil for kerosene, because of course kerosene was the way people lighted their houses, and so it was a very important commodity. And his business model, the business model of the trust, was all about running competitors out of business, so predatory pricing. And by 1890, in fact, he had rolled up the oil and gas industry. And people were starting to get pretty mad, right? Because he and his advisors figured out how to jack up the price of kerosene, and they had an arrangement with the railroads for distribution. And so there was some very abusive behavior going on. And when Teddy Roosevelt was elected president, really the second time, because he came into office, of course, after an assassination. But one of his interests was dealing with the trusts. He didn't really want to change the economic system, but he was concerned about the immense greed of the oil and gas trust, the meat producers trust. And so he helped jumpstart some investigations of these industries. And for Standard Oil Trust, Rockefeller's company, his plan was successful, and Standard Oil was given the task of coming up with their own plan for how they would be broken up. That's the part that I didn't learn about in history class. So what that meant is that there were many baby standards created. Actually, the company that we know today as Exxon ended up with about half the value of the Standard Oil Trust, and it often acted as a bank for the other baby standards. And interestingly enough, after this plan was started, a year after the breakup, Rockefeller's profits went up 20%. And in fact, all of the directors of the Standard Oil Trust continued to meet for lunch with Rockefeller in Manhattan every day. And they all had an interest in the baby standards, which have continued to consolidate over time. Now, these companies still, after literally hundreds of mergers and acquisitions, play a major role in energy policy in this country. And one of the things that I found most interesting in doing this research is the standards and a couple of a few other oil and gas companies that also were established around the turn of the 20th century, so early in the 1900s. They really shaped our rules and regulations about energy policy throughout the 20th century. And all of these companies in their merged states, which I'll discuss in a little bit, are among the 10 largest frackers today. But they've really enabled this kind of behavior by the energy industry through their political influence. And they have had enormous political influence in many, many areas. Now, a little other ancient history. You will remember that towards the end of World War I, the British and the French got together and decided how they were going to break up the Ottoman Empire, how they were going to form new countries, new boundaries, and create what we know as the Middle East today. And they did this for economic gain, and they said that they had different spheres of influence and made a lot of deals. Now, in the beginning, the U.S. was not involved in this, but once the U.S. Figured out what was happening, of course, our government too wanted to get in on this. And especially as oil continued to be developed. Now, these companies, the Seven Sisters that I was talking about, and I'll explain what the Seven Sisters are, these companies began to have a lot of influence on our federal government around the war, because of course oil is very important for winning wars. And Winston Churchill took the British Navy off of coal, put it onto oil. There was a real recognition that oil was going to be very important. So right before World War I began, some other companies were becoming very, very powerful. When oil was found in Texas, Gulf Oil and Texaco, were two of the companies that were formed. They are part of Chevron today. BP, had partially owned by the British government, was also formed around the beginning of the 19th century. And then the other big company was Shell. And these companies were referred to during the 20th century as the Seven Sisters. And that's kind of a takeoff on Greek mythology. If you've had Greek mythology, Atlas had seven daughters. They hated each other and fought, but if one of them was under attack, they all gathered around to protect her. And so these oil companies that were in collusion through most of the 20th century were nicknamed the Seven Sisters. So the Seven Sisters were meeting and dividing up territory almost from the beginning. And one of the decisions that they made in 1928 is that the concessions or the deals with the Middle Eastern countries that have oil, there would never be just one oil company, one major oil company doing production in one of these countries. They would always go in twos, threes, fours, fives. And that was because they were so suspicious of each other. And they wanted to keep production down, prices high. That was really the goal that they were working for. Now, later that year, the heads of the three largest companies, so I'm going to use modern names because it's much easier to keep track of. These companies change names many times. So Exxon, BP, and Shell met at a castle in Scotland and came up with a set of principles for keeping prices high, production low. Now, the reason they met is they were very nervous about oil being discovered in Iraq. They knew there was a lot of oil in Iraq. And really, from the 1920s on, the oil interests were, the American oil interests were allowed to run a kind of a separate foreign policy with these Middle Eastern countries, while there was another policy with the State Department. This isn't something I made up. This is very well documented. So these companies, the men got together, they wrote up this set of principles, how they were going to operate in the future, and then they met more times before World War II. And they brought the smaller companies in on their deal, even the independents. Now, this was discovered in 1952 when our federal government, Department of Justice, still was interested in investigating the oil industry's bad behavior. And they made the industry open their books. There were hearings, tens of thousands of pages of testimony about this price fixing. That we went through some of it for Frackopoly. So a lot of conniving about how to basically rip off consumers. Now, also in the 1920s, in fact it was 1918, the American Petroleum Institute, which is still the lobby arm of the industry, was put together by these major companies. And it continued to play a role in lobbying and being the front group for the oil and gas industry. Now, I want to briefly turn to the utility industry because a lot of bad behavior in the 1920s and similar behavior with the utility industry today has an impact on fracking. So for the historians among you, you may have heard of Samuel Insull. He was really kind of a brilliant but unethical businessman, worked with Thomas Edison on electricity. He developed an empire of electric and gas companies out of Chicago. And he had a structure. They got rid of the word trust, and they then started using, for these big, really multinational corporations, we call them today, he came up with a public holding company structure, so parent company and subsidiaries, and he figured out with this empire of 5,000 companies how to milk the profits up to the top holding companies. Not so unusual. But the other thing he did was start a bunch of investment companies. And those investment companies sold stock in the different utilities over and over and over again. It's called stock watering. This was some of the behavior that led to the crash of the stock market in 1929. And in fact, Insull's empire fell apart in 1932, About 700,000 stockholders lost their shirt, and a lot of people lost their energy services. So you can imagine, we know how angry and worried people were about the Depression and the horrible impact it had on people in this country. So when FDR, Franklin Roosevelt, came into office, one of the things that advocates for consumers, often municipal officials at that time, were demanding that something be done about these public utility holding companies, especially for energy services. And one of the most contentious bills in the early part of the New Deal was the passage of the Public Utility Holding Company Act, which forbid a lot of this bad behavior in the electric industry. The gas was left out of this bill, and I'll talk about another piece of legislation in a moment that regulated natural gas. But what this bill did, and it's very important, it limited the size of electric utilities, required them to open their books to the Security and Exchange Commission to make sure they weren't ripping off consumers. They were not allowed to gamble with ratepayers' money, a lot of ways to limit their size. I'm going to talk about the repeal of that a little later in the story. So a couple years later, in 1938, these consumer advocates were able to get the natural gas industry regulated under the Natural Gas Act. And this did something. Of course, this has all been repealed as well, but it required the Federal Power Commission, a federal agency, to set the price for natural gas. And this was a way to stop consumers who were being ripped off from high natural gas prices for heating fuel and things that gas was used for in those days. So they were supposed to set the price of gas based on the cost of producing it, plus a fair profit that was between about 5.6 and 7%. One of the reasons that utilities were considered a safe place to invest money. So, you know, this worked pretty well, both of these pieces of legislation, but you can imagine how furious, how angry the electric utility and the oil and gas industry were. And in fact, the red baiting began almost immediately, and they would call people that supported this kind of regulation communists. They were investigated. People lost their jobs, and there was tremendous political pressure for several decades to get rid of this legislation. And in fact, every Congress, there would be legislation introduced to get rid of the Public Utility Holding Company Act and the Natural Gas Act. But the World War II did intervene, and for a while all of these industries had to work together to win the war. But one of the things that really benefited the oil and gas industry is a lot of the new technologies that were developed. The ability to pipe long distances. There were some pipes, the big inch and the little inch pipelines that went from, one of them went from Texas to Chicago. The little inch went on up into the Northeast. It was the biggest project in the States during World War II. It took 16,000 men to build, and after the war it was privatized. And those pipes are still in use today. But the point is that the oil and gas industry really benefited from a lot of this federal research, has always benefited from federal research. Now, the other thing that happened around the time of the war is that the oil and gas industry was very upset about people wanting to regulate the environmental pollution from smokestacks and from mining, and very concerned about fossil fuel production and use and how it was polluting the air and making people sick. So the industry had a meeting in the mid-1940s at Chevron's office in Los Angeles, where they created a smoke and fumes committee, always called the Smoke and Fumes Committee, and they started funding research into the environmental problems of fossil fuel. This has recently come out just in the last few months by the some lawsuits that the Center for International Environmental Law was able to be successful with. And they put on their website a lot of these documents through the decades from the Smoke and Fumes Committee. And they continued to pay scientists to do this research up into the 1960s. The research might have been done by reputable scientists, often was, but it was their interest was in how they could use their knowledge to keep environmental laws from being passed. So it was really a very, you know, disingenuous and unethical behavior. And it turns out, you know, we often hear about the tobacco industry, having known from the early days that cigarettes caused cancer. Well, there were interlocking boards of directors between the tobacco industry and the fossil fuel industry, and actually the tobacco industry learned from the oil and gas playbook, it turns out, on how to misuse science. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about this when we get to the Nixon administration. So things got really interesting after the war. There were both advocates for and advocates against the oil and gas industry. Lots of very colorful characters or scoundrels. One of my favorite scoundrels, and I think it's because he wears a big hat and, you know, he's a big guy, and he was in Congress for about 15 years until he died of a heart attack in office. He had been a governor of Oklahoma. His name was Senator Robert Kerr, and he owned a big oil and gas company, Kerr McGee, that also actually got into uranium production, another story. But he saw his job in the U.S. Senate as doing everything he could to help his company and the oil and gas industry. He would often introduce this legislation to do away with regulation. He was key in helping to get a lot of the breaks that the oil and gas industry enjoys. One of my favorite is the Golden Gimmick, still in existence today. It's a special tax break for companies that produce oil in Saudi Arabia. Kind of a long story, but I have it in the book. He also was one of the Congress people instrumental in getting that tax break for oil companies and gas companies when they use up their resources. They actually get to subtract that from their taxes. So, you know, it's a lot of subsidies and tax breaks for these industry. But there were also at this time a lot of good advocates trying to stop this in Congress. People who conducted massive hearings and investigations and really tried to fight the industry. Another favorite villain, though, is John J. McCloy. And, you know, he was one of these kind of invisible people who is in every, works in government for Republican or Democrat, kind of below the radar, but has a very important role. He played a role from the Roosevelt administration when he was in the War Office all the way to the Reagan administration when he died, when Reagan was in office. But he was a Harvard-trained lawyer. He had a lot of different jobs, political jobs. But the one that he really kept and focused on was being an attorney for the what was left of the Rockefeller Empire, oil and gas empire, and their bank, Chase Bank. And representing the Seven Sisters in the different fights for exemptions from antitrust law and helping them collude against antitrust law, because for decades, antitrust law was actually taken seriously, and companies were worried that they would get caught colluding to fix prices and do these things. So that was his job. Love this quote that he had, a Harvard-trained lawyer who said that, why, the Constitution is just a scrap of paper for me. He also was quoted in retirement as saying his job was to keep him out of jail, referring to the oil companies. So a lot of really interesting people. And of course, Richard Nixon was a big fan of the oil and gas industry. He played a pretty important role in facilitating oil and gas usage. He opened up a lot of the coastal areas to drilling for oil. He actually, for his re-election campaign, oil executives were among those who delivered cash in suitcases. I have one instance in Frackopoly where an oil executive delivered $700,000 in a suitcase. You know, not all of these things can be documented, but that particular case could be. He also played a real role in weakening the Federal Power Commission, which regulated natural gas. And one of his appointees was his name's Pinckney Walker. He was a right-wing legal scholar. And one of his graduate students was Ken Lay, for those of you who remember Ken Lay, who was involved in the deregulation of electricity, defrauding Californians, basically causing blackouts, and who was one of the big proponents of deregulating natural gas. He really learned how the natural gas and electricity industry are regulated when he worked at the Federal Power Commission. And by the way, he was working in Washington to escape being drafted for the Vietnam War. But so that just one of the ways that Richard Nixon really had an impact. Now, I mentioned that Smoke and Fumes Committee. One of the things that happened during the tenure of Nixon is that the Smoke and Fumes Committee had compiled a lot of academic research on climate change. They had begun compiling this research in the 1950s, it turns out. And they knew by 1968 what the impact would be on the future of climate change. They knew that the ice caps would begin to melt, that oceans would rise, that there would be a loss of biodiversity, that there would be erratic weather. This is all coming out now in documents. So it's not just something that happened in the 1980s that Exxon was lying about it. This was a scheme by the oil and gas industry to really keep this from the public eye and to keep producing and using fossil fuels no matter what the impact would be. Now, the other thing that Nixon did that I think is a marker and has had a major impact on our democracy and oil and gas use, but an impact on a lot of issues. And that is both his appointment of Lewis Powell to the Supreme Court and Lewis Powell's affinity for the Chamber of Commerce and his anger about what was happening in the late 1960s and early 1970s. So before Powell took office as a Supreme Court judge, he was a corporate lawyer, represented the tobacco industry a lot, out of Richmond, Virginia. And he was very active in the Chamber of Commerce. And one of his colleagues there asked him to write something about what corporate America was facing, how to get rid of liberal values. So I don't really think this is a conspiracy, but I do think this is a marker and shows how a lot of economic forces can work together. So he wrote what, you know, you can actually use your web browser to come up with this memo today. It's about 15 pages long. And it's called the Powell Manifesto or the Powell Memo. And it lays out how to really change the nation's values, basically. How the university was too liberal, how the pulpit ministers were talking about the Vietnam War and the civil rights movement. Basically, he was part of a cadre of people who did not like how society was moving on, angry at the Warren Court for extending rights to new classes of people, angry about the civil rights movement, angry about the fight back against the Vietnam War, angry that Walter Cronkite would talk about these issues on the nightly news. So, you know, this memo does lay out a very good plan, but what Powell did was he didn't just talk about it, but he put together helped put together the money to make this happen. One of my favorite quotes of his is that strength lies in organization, in careful long-range planning, in the scale of financing available only through joint effort, and in the political power available only through united action and national organizations. He wrote that in 1971. He went out to the Koch family, the Coors family, Skafe Mellon, which is Gulf Oil, and a lot of the wealthiest supporters of Goldwater in 1964, and began to put together a plan and the money to start, well, more than 100 right-wing think tanks, places like the Heritage Foundation that today are, you know, one of the most quoted so-called objective sources of information. And he was also very close to the oil and gas industry. He also, as a Supreme Court justice, wrote the first decision about corporations having the right to political talk. So he really began that whole movement towards Citizens United. And I think it's just always worth noting when these major changes in our society began to take place and how the money was organized to make this happen. And, you know, obviously it's not just about the oil and gas industry, it's about weakening our democracy in so many ways. So this story then moves on to the Carter administration. And, of course, there was an oil price crisis under the Carter administration for a lot of geopolitical reasons that I don't have time to get into tonight. But one of the impacts is that when Jimmy Carter came into office, energy was on people's minds. And today, many people remember Carter for the research that he helped jumpstart on alternative energy. But a lot of other important things around energy happened under the Carter administration. That lobbying that I was talking about by the oil and gas industry and the utility industry really reached a crescendo during the Carter administration. One of the things that he did is put together a plan for moving all of the energy-related functions in the federal government under a new agency called the Department of Energy that would be responsible for research, development, everything to do with energy. And also during this period, there were repeated attempts to deregulate natural gas. And natural gas pricing was deregulated when the Carter administration was in office. Obviously, this was congressional action. And under this new Department of Energy, a new federal agency was created called the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission. And people who are following very closely the pipelines and the new power lines know that FERC has a lot of power. So FERC was put under the Department of Energy, but the president was given the job of appointing the commissioners. The oil and gas industry was jubilant about getting rid of natural gas pricing. Now, some of the testimony and investigations during this period, and I documented this through congressional testimony, is the industry, to actually be able to get this deregulation, had been withholding gas and saying they're not making enough money, regulation is the problem, we have to have more money or we're not going to drill. And they would withhold gas in areas of the country where there were legislators, Congress people, who were trying to regulate them and watchdog them. And eventually the power became just too great. And almost immediately, new pipelines began to be developed during this period. There was also already lots of research being done really since the beginning of the oil and gas industry to benefit the dirty energy industry. And under the Carter administration, a lot of this research on shale was jump-started because of the energy crisis and this desire to find new sources of domestic oil and gas. And many of the technologies, if you've there are a bunch of books written on fracking that talk as if we just had these brilliant entrepreneurs that came up with these new technologies on their own because they're, just so brilliant and the free market allowed them to do it. But if you really look at a lot of the things that have allowed the directional drilling, actually the experimentation by Mitchell Associates, one of the companies that began the fracking in Texas, all paid for by the Department of Energy. So it's always important to point out that a lot of the decisions made in the 20th century have determined what kind of energy we would be using today. So this really brings us up into the Reagan administration. And as I mentioned earlier in my talk, the real evisceration of antitrust law and allowing companies to get so large that they have enough political power that they could basically dictate to Congress and to agencies what public policy should be, that really was jump-started under the Reagan administration. And in fact, the economic interests who put together the money for his candidacy. And under the Reagan administration, the two agencies that oversee antitrust are Department of Justice and the Federal Trade Commission, depending on the industry. And under President Reagan, the heads of these agencies were given the job of firing staff, reducing the budgets dramatically, and I think most important for us today, narrowing the definition of what an antitrust violation actually is. And even with that narrow, weak definition, there has been no appetite, really by any administration of either party, to really go after antitrust. What happened to me? So one of the brain trust of the Reagan administration was Robert Bork, who is a right-leaning legal scholar who came up with the theory that antitrust law is bad and that really it's good to let companies become much bigger because it's very, very, very efficient. And of course, Reagan tried to appoint Bork to the Supreme Court, but that was aborted. But a lot of the things that we're still living with today began under the Reagan administration, this whole idea of the self-policing market, that bigger is better, and we're literally living with the consequences today. And I believe in picking on both political parties because most of these decisions about antitrust, and certainly today actually about oil and gas, have been embraced by both political parties. And I think it was under the Clinton administration that a lot of the public policies were either passed or came into fruition because of his support. So the deregulation of the financial services industry, the Financial Services Modernization Act, really has created the casino-type stock market that we have today. And we probably would never have had that crash in 2008, 2009, because those rules were put in place to stop the behavior that happened in the 1920s that led to the stock market crash, and many of those same behaviors leading to a bubble brought on our most recent crash. And so deregulation of financial services has also created this situation where they are able to be in bed with the financial or with the energy and oil and gas companies. And a lot of the other mergers took place under the Clinton administration. Things really moved along then, of course, under the Obama administration when the Energy Policy Act of 2005 was passed. The Halliburton loophole, which many people know about, named after Dick Cheney's former company, Halliburton, exempted the oil and gas industry from the Safe Drinking Water Act, that Public Utility Holding Company Act that I talked about. Was repealed. That has allowed the utility industry to consolidate. We have about 20 giant utilities that control more than 50% of electricity production, are engaged in activities with the oil and gas industry, that speculate on energy futures, and it's just the kind of cabal that the Public Utility Holding Company Act was trying to prevent. And then, of course, the Energy Regulatory Commission was given new powers, including oversight of one of our nation's most important environmental laws, the National Environmental Policy Act, which means that there has to be, says that there has to be an environmental assessment of big projects like these pipelines. Well, FERC is in charge of that assessment now. And they also were given the power to override states and localities in condemning land for pipelines and for electric power lines. And sadly, we just haven't seen the kind of movement on fracking and oil and gas under the Obama administration. There's really been this idea that we should have all of the above strategy, everything, fossil fuels, nuclear energy, a lot of support for natural gas. A lot of the appointees of the Obama administration have been very friendly to natural gas. And the studies of water pollution that I mentioned earlier have been closed down, and a very weak study was put together on the environmental effects on water of fracking. So there is a lot of work ahead of us for a new administration. And what this reconsolidation of the oil and gas industry means is that the seven sisters are now four major oil and gas companies: Shell, Exxon, BP, and Chevron. And the consolidation has been made up of literally hundreds of mergers and acquisitions. And what happens when prices go low in the oil and gas industry? The big guys gobble up more companies. And one of the things that I found in writing Frackopoly is that it's a boom-bust cycle with oil and gas since the very beginning. And so, unfortunately, prices will go back up, and we will need to make the policy changes to really keep fossil fuels in the ground. And these big companies are among the 10 largest frackers, but I think the most important point is that over the course of the 20th century, they really had the biggest impact on the laws that still govern the oil and gas and energy industry. They have enabled this situation that we have today to really happen. And of course, there is a relationship between the utility industry and oil and gas, and many new natural gas power plants are being planned where shale is being fracked. And in the long run, we see that coal, the rules have been changed so that coal is disincentivized, which of course is a good thing because coal is a very dirty energy source. But at the same time, rules are incentivizing the use of natural gas. And even unfortunately, the Obama administration's Clean Power Plan, which is in court, of course, it is really focused on incentivizing natural gas. And financial schemes like trading, emissions trading, rather than really building the political power so that we can keep fossil fuels in the ground. But we can't lose hope. And I think that is one of the reasons that I also wrote Frackopoly, because the last third of the book is really about all of the movement victories. And of course, since its publication, there have been many more victories. And nobody says that this is easy, but I think that we have seen the impact of the movement in this nation around fracking. We would not have seen fracking be a topic in the fight for the Democratic nomination for president, right? The Sanders-Clinton fight. I mean, over fracking, that is really because a movement has lifted that issue and the issue of global climate justice really to the top. And there have been hundreds of communities taking action against fracking. States to either ban fracking or to have a moratorium. New York has banned it, Vermont has banned it, Maryland has a moratorium. There is a big effort to get a ban there this year. Florida, surprisingly, has had made a lot of progress. Over 70% of the population of Florida their jurisdictions have either banned or have a moratorium on fracking. 16 major large jurisdictions or cities. And last year we were able to defeat legislation that would have allowed the kind of acid fracking that they want to do there, basically using acids instead of water. But that was a major success. So we're making progress, and a majority of Americans now oppose fracking, and there is just a tremendous amount of activism around the country. And I know I was really thrilled in Philadelphia the day before the Democratic convention. We had a major clean energy revolution march that 10,000 people came to, even though it was 100 degrees. 900 groups from 50 states signed on to this. And I do think that the momentum is building for this clean energy revolution, and that each of us have to work in our communities and our states to really make this happen. And I know after the election that there are going to be all sorts of things that must be done to keep growing this movement and to make progress on this important issue, because our only solution for the future is really to keep fossil fuels in the ground. So I think, thank you for bearing with me on those slides. Very odd not to point to the slides, but we are excited that this will be on the radio, so.
We really want to thank the Albuquerque Public Library, and there is an election, and we do want you to vote, and whatever it is you want to vote for, but please go out and vote. We want to thank Bookworks as well. So I guess we have time for a couple of questions.
Yeah, a couple of questions, sure.
Yes.
I just want to know about where is fracking happening in New Mexico?
Eleanor,
fracking is, and there's people here to help me out with this. Fracking has been going on in New Mexico for 60 years. The really dangerous, of course, started in 2005. But we have two areas where fracking has been going on, the far northwest and the far southeast. But fracking is coming to your neighborhood because they're running out in these areas. So there's a lady over here, her backyard, literally, they wanted to put a fracking well there last year. We fought very hard, and we chased it off, but it's coming. They will come everywhere in New Mexico, because we have shale.
Yes.
Me? Okay. I just wanted to raise a couple of points. Those of us who live here in Albuquerque have some very special issues. Number one, we live with the biggest fuel oil spill on land in the history of the United States, and the city and the county and the state do virtually nothing about it. It has been going on for years. The fuel oil has floated on the aquifer and the water in the aquifer, and nobody has any idea how far it has gone. It is adjacent to the best well fields that we have. We have an arsenic problem in the water, and the fuel oil spill is adjacent to the Ridgecrest well fields, which have the best water in the metropolitan area. The reason I think that they haven't done anything about it is because they don't want to kill the golden goose. This city lives largely off governmental funds. We get over $6 billion a year from Sandy and Kirtland, and they don't want to alienate them, and therefore they have been worse than foot-dragging on this issue. So I agree with everything you say, but fracking is not the whole story. The other thing is, just to say it briefly, there is a third-party candidate running who is a former governor of the state. His name is Gary something or another, and he has made it clear that he doesn't want the government to regulate anything. He is completely anti-regulation. He, according to the papers, is getting 24% of the vote in this state. This to me is very frightening, but it illustrates that many people are not concerned about regulation of anything.
That's for sure. Okay, we had a hand there and then here.
Hello, my name is Elaine Chena, and we've been working on Stop Fracking the Rio Grande Valley. And we're facing over 8,000 wells coming down the West Mesa. And 55,000 acres had been leased out through Jim Mammoth and Thrust Energy, who has Grooms, who is a SEC broker, who has been getting all the multinationals to invest in fracking in New Mexico and in Sandoval County and in Bernalillo County and on. We also have Zia Puebla, who has 33,000 acres, who is allowing some of these top 20 frackers, who are the most egregious emissions violators in the country, to start fracking even further west of those other 5,000 wells that are coming up. We don't have a legislature who will stand up to them. Because I think, because of how you pointed out in your lecture about being held hostage by the oil companies, what is your suggestions to start dealing with the money aspect? Because I don't think we're going to solve this problem by standing on street corners with signs. We need to go after the money. And the SEC is not going to help us. The government's not going to help us. And so I just would like to know. I have that question for you.
Well, our philosophy is there's no easy answer to this, and we have to build political power community by community. Of course, it's a much heavier lift.
Where the industry is
targeting, and where you have the kind of hostage situation that you're talking about. But I think it's doing electoral politics, it's doing the outreach, it's putting together a strategy for short-term goals that can take you to a bigger goal. I mean, that's really how progress is being made. And I think it's a long-term battle that we're in, not something that's going to change tomorrow. And I don't think there's anything around doing the kind of organizing, political organizing, building political power to actually make our elected officials accountable. And it does, I think, start locally and at the state level. Okay, I think we have you and then room for two more short comments or questions, because it's getting late.
Well, I've got a response to what we do about the economics. Food and Water Watch had that diagram of the financial underpinnings to Standing Rock, right? So I took that list and I did some research, and it turns out there's 6 to 8 of those companies that have tens of millions of dollars that have retail operations in Albuquerque.
Yeah, they do.
Which means we can let people know that. And when I talked about this at a demonstration, Standing Rock demonstration, people said, I didn't know Wells Fargo was financing Standing Rock. I'm going to close my account. So this is one of the things we can do.
Yeah, right. And it's a good education tool, too.
Right. So the other thing I want to say real quickly is, you talked about the federal Clean Power Plan and Obama as being a smokescreen. You didn't use these words exactly, a smokescreen for the gas industry, okay? There is a number of environmental organizations, national organizations, and with local affiliates here that have been taken in by that.
Yeah, I know.
And it's really upsetting to me. Conservation Voter Alliance and Juntos in Albuquerque are using the Clean Power Plan as their lead organizing tool. Right?
It's a real problem.
It's a
I mean, I talk about some of the environmental politics in Frackopoly because it's, you know, a lot of groups, there's a lot of political pressure and a lot of people have been taken in by the natural gas industry. I mean, it depends on what group you're talking about. I mean, I think some groups, like the Environmental Defense Fund, for instance, have been in on this plan for a long time and don't have a problem with it, but it's difficult. Okay. I don't have an answer to it.
The Sierra Club was originally, but they figured out that they'd been taken in and they backed away.
They had pressure from their members, and I think that's what's held the Sierra Club more accountable. And that's, I think, one of the things that people have to do. The elect groups know if they're a member that they're not going to support a group that goes along with the natural gas myth. Okay.
Okay, I am particularly interested in the Four Corners area, and as you probably heard, NASA with the methane hotspot and everything. So there's the methane and then there's the water problem, but there's also there's a lot of fracking that is getting pretty close to chapter one. And so one of my concerns or questions to you is actually, how do we know that earthquakes won't happen in that area, like they do in Oklahoma or Arkansas? I mean, what makes
the land
prime for earthquakes?
I mean, it is, there are geological, physical attributes that make some areas more prime. But we also know that one of the reasons is because so much more waste, they're injecting such large volumes of waste at such high pressure. So I've done some reading on this. I don't think there is any assurance.
So the earthquakes have happened out anywhere?
They've happened in a number of states. Arkansas,
Kansas,
Ohio,
Kansas.
And there's a lot of work that the Geologic Service is doing, of course. Everything's politicized, so you have to dig through this stuff to find it because everybody's scared to death to talk about this.
Can you just mention one thing? I just in response to the person, in Sandoval County, is just, first of all, I want to thank the people, because I live in Sandoval County, I want to thank the people that pushed back on the fracking. I work on other issues at the legislature, not specifically this one, but I appreciate what you've done. And I guess I just want to say, not for people to give up, because the legislature here, we still have amazing access to our legislators, unlike any other state, where you can walk in, you can meet your legislator for coffee, and I would encourage everybody to get to know your legislator and put tremendous pressure on them. You and your friends and neighbors meet with them and demand that they act in accordance with what you want. And you know, you can really change how they vote if you put up enough pressure. So don't give up, just fight back.
I just wanted to make one comment, because you bring together the synergistic capability that we still might have. And I think that all of this is about, we thankfully, because of this election cycle, the argument between the concept of safe fracking, which is Senator Clinton's perspective, and the no fracking, which is Senator Sanders' perspective, is finally at the forefront of people understanding that this is a major issue that cannot be just waved away. The legislative struggle for us as a state is that our education budget policy, every major budget policy in the state of New Mexico is tied. And if I'm incorrect, please correct me.
A third of the money that we get for education
comes from the extractive industry. So yes, it's
I'm sorry.
Well, I'm just saying
issue, so I'm just wondering if anyone else.